coming, but the decisions you make right now help you build a better one. Do you want a future where technology constrains your business or empowers it? Will you innovate for the sake of it, or innovate so you're closer to your customers? Do you want to be reactive to what's happening or relevant for tomorrow? Will you choose profit over planet, or will you find profit in sustainability? Partner with Capgemini now and unlock the value of technology to transform your business. Capgemini. Get the future you want.
Good evening, everybody. I welcome you all to Entrepreneurship Awareness Drive 2021, presented by Capgemini, co-powered by Cisco, and empowered by L&T Financial Services, being held in the city of Lakes, Udaipur. Established in 2006 with the support of Science and Technology Entrepreneurs Park, Entrepreneurship Cell IIT Kharagpur has always worked to promote the startup culture and inculcate the entrepreneur knowledge among the enthusiasts. Started 12 years ago, Entrepreneurship Awareness Drive hails with an objective to promote entrepreneurship in colleges all across the country. Unlike all its previous 11 editions, EAD 2021 is the largest online awareness drive of its kind, spanning across 25 major cities and inviting 45 plus speakers. After successfully hosting EADs in various other parts of India, now we are extremely excited to start the much awaited EAD Udaipur. I am Sanskar Nankani, Associate Member at Entrepreneurship Cell IIT Kharagpur, and we have with us one of India's top-notch tech minds, Mr. Swami Sitharaman. Swami Sitharaman heads engineering and data at CRED. He has over 25 plus years of experience in creating technology transformations, product strategy, and building organizations from ground up. Prior to his role at CRED, Swami sir was the CEO of Pienta, a home healthcare startup that has since acquired by Gojek. Apart from his work in the world of tech, Swami sir is the co-founder of Agam, a carnative progressive rock act from India with a penchant for arranging music and writing poetry. Today, Swami sir will speak on creativity versus execution in starting up. Without further ado, I would like to hand over the stage to Swami sir. Please drop your questions in the Q&A session, and we'll be taking up at the end of the session. Over to you, sir.
Thanks, Sanskar, and thanks to Entrepreneurship Cell IIT Kharagpur for this opportunity. I'm super stoked to be among a lot of brilliant minds here. So very brief intro, just don't want to add, already Sanskar had introduced me. So I am going to wearing three hats today in this conversation. One being a co-founder of a rock band, and one being an entrepreneur which was with Pienta, which is a home healthcare startup. And the third one would be about what I'm doing at CRED. So I'm going to be sharing a lot of my stories in general about entrepreneurship and how has my journey been there? What are the things that resonate with me, right? So that's going to be, let's get started without further ado. So if I really look at, most of you are on the verge of, you know, either passing out or in third or fourth year and very eager to explore entrepreneurship as a career itself, right? I mean, who knows, you can start right out of your college and you don't need to go and work for an organization. You could go and start up, right? Now let's look at why this is a great time and why time is ripe right now, right? If you look at it, India is the third largest startup ecosystem after US and China. I'm not sure if many of you realize that. India has, every month, India has three unicorns coming up, right? India has a total of 51 unicorns and only after US and China, right? And you'll be surprised to know that UK has only 32 unicorns and Germany 18. Now, with the recent IPOs of Zomato, Freshdesk, it just infused so much of energy and optimism here, right? And so many new IPOs are sort of lined up. Billions of dollars has been pumped into the ecosystem, right? You are at a time where there are a lot of startup incubators, accelerators. There are venture capitalists who are willing to give grants. The venture capitalists we're going to support. There are angels who are there to help you seed your dream, right? And there are so many mentors out there. This wasn't the case, let's say, 10, 15 years. It was just evolving. Now, if you really look at India itself, right, there is 623 million, the recent one. 623 million internet users. That's massive, right? And we'll be 900 million by 2025. We have right now 45% internet penetration. Infrastructure has tremendously improved. Bandwidth has increased. So the really, really time is ripe. If someone wants to take entrepreneurship, it can't be a better time where the ecosystem is completely with you, right, to start. So I would definitely like to say that, hey, look, if you're looking to wanting to be an entrepreneur, great time. Go for it. There cannot be a better time. Now, with that context, let me just talk a little bit about traits of entrepreneurs that I've observed. And also, I will also talk about when probably not to process entrepreneurship as an option, right? Let's talk about a little bit about traits of entrepreneurs that I have seen, right? Entrepreneurs are very ambitious. They have raw passion. They're very competitive. They're very obsessed to win. They really want they want to make it happen, right? That's one of the traits. Other one is audacity, right? Which is going after big, bold bets and not just playing safe, right? Really going for the kill. I've seen entrepreneurs anticipating future, like being able to live in the future and being able to be a change agent, right? They can break norms. They change status quo and they condition new behaviors, right? Entrepreneurship is not about, hey, this idea is there. I'm also going to, you know, copy and try and see if it works, because the ecosystem is very, very supportive right now, right? Entrepreneurs have very higher appetite for risk, which means they are willing to make sacrifices. They're willing to take risk and go for it, right? Other one, which is related to the topic also, as Sanskar was saying, is about creativity. Entrepreneurs have a good way to sort of take creativity and sort of convert that into actionables, which can be executed as ideas, right? Not just it doesn't stay with an idea, but an idea getting executed and realizing. Entrepreneurs create wealth. They are passionate about creating wealth. They're obsessed with customers. They're very comfortable with ambiguity. They are okay to have battle scars, right? They will see failure every other day. So these are broad traits of entrepreneurs. I'm going to go and give you some examples, right? Real life examples and stories. One thing I would advise all of you is don't take entrepreneurship because your friend or your senior or you saw someone being successful. I think it has to be your true calling, something you have to be really, really passionate about, saying that, hey, look, I want to do this because I'm very passionate about it. It can be about wealth creation. It can be about making tons of money. Nothing wrong in that. Or it can be for a cause. You can think about environment, education. It can be about anything. It can be about creating a brand. It can be about creating history, right? So it can be about anything, but it has to be a true calling. Like, just make sure that you are really in when you're becoming an entrepreneur. Now, let me just quickly go into some of the stories from my world in the last 15, 20 years of my experience, right? I think until 2005, 2004, I didn't know. When I realized that I could play keyboard and I was very interested in music, was when I was 29 years old, 28, 29 years old. So until then, I didn't know that I could, right? And by chance, once I asked my sister to get me a keyboard and then I started playing, then I realized that this is something that I would have always wanted to do, right? So why I'm talking about this is you will never know in life what is in store for you. Similarly, in entrepreneurship, right? Be open, be curious, and be patient. Like, you will never know. It's a discovery. It's a journey with discovery. It's not something that you will say that, hey, this is exactly how it is going to end or it is going to proceed. You have to just go with the flow. But on the journey, make wise decision and be fully in, right? So basically, age is no bar. There is nothing that will stop you from becoming an entrepreneur, but just be open. Be open, be patient, be curious, keep discovering. Now, let me also talk about, once you take entrepreneurship, if you think everything will be hunky-dory, it won't be, right? I started Pianta after working for about 15, 16 years or maybe more. And I was a first time entrepreneur. But if I had said that, hey, look, I've worked for so long and I have all the entitlement, and I would have never made any progress, right? I'll talk to you guys a little about a band. It's a rock band called Agam. When we started, there weren't anyone who was calling us to come and play. We literally went through every venue saying that, hey, look, we are a new band. This is a genre of music we play. Here are our CDs. In those days, we had CDs. And we went to every venue saying that, hey, can we come and play? I still remember we played our first gig in a music shop of all places, right? And we have done these small gigs, and then word of mouth, people talking about it, and some amplification from social media really helped us. But I don't think there was anyone who is going to come and say, hey, everything's on platter because you have great credentials. Or if you have raised money, let's say you have raised an angel or seed round, I don't think it means anything, right? So there is no entitlement of the past. And you have to keep saying that as an entrepreneur every year. There is, because pretty much the market dynamics, like everything is moving fast. Now, I also want to sort of talk a little bit about luck, right? How does luck play a part in entrepreneurship, right? I think people who are very passionate and work very hard, they attract luck and they are very open. But just because luck comes in, I don't think luck can make anyone great. Right? Good luck, if you get a good luck, unless and until you take leverage and ride on it, I don't think by itself it is going to make you great, right? So there is this book by Jim Collins called From Good to Great. It talks about, hey, good luck cannot make you great, but bad luck can kill you, right? So it's a very profound thought. Now, again, I will go back to in terms of luck as Agam, right? So I still remember in 2001, we went and played in a reality show down south. It was judged by Raymanji. And we were in the quarterfinals and we lost the quarterfinals. And Raymanji actually took note of a band and said that, no, I believe in them. And he gave a wild card for us, right? These are the small little things that happened in our career, which we really very grateful to, but also we're realizing that these are the moments of luck. Then in 2011, we were playing in Coorg, there's a festival called Storm Festival, right? The MTV crew incidentally had been there to cover that festival and they saw us playing, and we were invited to play just because we played there and they saw us. They invited us to play for Coke Studio, right? Season 2, we played one song in the season, episode 8, if I remember it correctly, right? So again, luck comes in your way. It always keeps coming. You have to just look for it. And when it comes, really grab on. Because what we did after we did the MTV Coke Studio season is we said that, hey, look, we need to work very hard and we need to get our new album produced. And then we said that, hey, we need money to raise money to do the new album. And at that time, I just want to talk about two things and reflect here as an entrepreneur, right? As an entrepreneur, you'll have to do everything. At Pianta, I have clean toilet also. Like, I don't feel ashamed to say that. It's as an entrepreneur, you need to do everything. And I'll give an example of Agam. So I had to raise money. I had to raise about, let's say, 6-7 lakhs at the time for producing an album. So one of the chief editor of a very renowned media publication was talking to me saying that, hey, look, we have this November Fest and we want your band to play for, at 3 cities in India. So the first time I went doing sales role, right? And I said, like, I want this amount. He said, like, how do you justify this amount? I said, no, this is the one that will help us achieve our dream, which is first to get our first album out. I need to produce it. And we feel we are worth it. And because I'm prioritizing what I really want now to realize my dream. Therefore, if you guys give us this, then we'll take the gig, right? I think it was a stand we took. At the time, and the rest is history, right? We launched our first album, we toured all over India, we toured world, we launched our second album. But these are small moments that as an entrepreneur, you have to watch out for. and build on luck, and don't just leave, oh, I got lucky, and then leave it. Just go and make sure you get multiplier outcomes for it. Now, let me talk about entrepreneurship and wealth creation, right? Because everyone thinks that, hey, if you're an entrepreneur, you need to make tons of money. Yes, absolutely. Wealth creation, part and parcel of entrepreneurship. Creation of job opportunities, part of entrepreneurship. Not just for you, you'll create wealth for everyone. But think about entrepreneurship is not just about, in my opinion, about wealth creation, right? Take scientists, right? There are a lot of innovations they have done. And I don't think their generation, second generation, third generation are making a lot of money. We're still probably using those innovations. Some of them don't even get paid royalty, but they were very proud of what they created. That was more important, right? I'm not saying don't focus on money, important to focus on money, but equally important. Some people, so I was talking about true calling. Your true calling about, it could be about climate change. It could be about education. It could be about anything. And that, that true calling and your ability to connect to that no matter what will take out all the external motivators you need to be an entrepreneur. Everything will be driven from inside. Like if I take Agam, our primary goal was not to monetize, right? Our primary goal was to create a brand. We said that we accidentally, discovered a brand which is a sort of mix of Carnatic and progressive rock, which both of them have complex time signatures and which go very well. But then our aspiration was to make this brand stay through time, like, and make sure this stays for a very long time. That was more for us, right? More than making money. Let me talk a little bit about entrepreneurship, how sexy it is from outside. What is really inside? You become an entrepreneur, you say, hey, I'm going to start a company, right? But if you think that it's going to be a cozy ride, absolutely a mistaken. Difficult roads lead to beautiful destinations. There has to be a lot of sacrifices. Understandably, you do sacrifices, you are not going to win, right? Most entrepreneurs, they either put money from their pocket because they believe in something, and you're not going to be getting money in, right? And even if you raise money, entrepreneurs typically take whatever very, very adequate for them to basically ensure their life moves on, right? But it's, so think about a time where you're not going to have inflow of money, you're going to have outflow of money, you're going to be looking at failures every day, setbacks every day, but you are yet so passionate about mission and you're moving forward every single day. You want your passion and you want what you want to achieve as a dream. You're only focused on that. So you need to have sacrifices, part and parcel of it. If you think that entrepreneurship is an instant gratification, you'll be mistaken, right? I'll give an example, right? At CRED, let me talk a little bit about CRED and Anagam. There are some similarities, right? The head of design at CRED is also the lead singer at Agam. So we jam both inside and outside the company. But CRED, not sure how many of you know, the first version went through 17 design iterations. All of this happened in 100 days, right? 17 design iteration it went through. 6 times we built the product, fully built the product. We did whole bunch of user research and testing, right? But it took time. It took iteration. It was a lot more craftsmanship. It was not an instant gratification. Hey, let's just put something out, right? Similarly, in Agam, the number of songs that we have written and, you know, sort of arranged and thrown is way more than the number of songs that we have released, right? And so therefore, you need to be patient. You're going to have a lot of setbacks. You're going to operate in ambiguity. You would not know what will happen tomorrow. You would not know, you know, you'll realize that, hey, in 3 months, the bank balance is sort of getting too negative. Like, what do? I have people, I have to pay them. Like, people are working, right? These are the situations you're going to, you need to also handle as an entrepreneur, right? So all I'm saying that when you're coming, and you want to become an entrepreneur, be ready to sacrifice. because think about this way, right? There is only finite bandwidth for all of us. We have 24 hours, and out of which we sleep for 8 hours. So now, with that finite bandwidth, and if you want to become an entrepreneur, you need to give everything that you got. Like, for example, in 2014 or 2013, we did 57 gigs, right? And we were all working at Agam. The good thing is the lead guitarist heads product at Super Daily. The other rhythm guitarist, he heads product at Airbnb. Singer is head of design. The bass, he heads sales at HUL. I work at Cred. Like, all of us are working in different cities. We all get together to play. And we played 57 gigs in a year, right? In within India and outside India. But he still worked. And that required a lot of sacrifices. And without the sacrifice, there is a time. And because we had to take care of very important responsibility that we play in these companies, which are very supportive. But you also need to make time for what you really want to do. So all I'm trying to say is you have to give up something. And if you want something, and if you want entrepreneurship, you have to give up. Definitely have to give up things which are not important and not urgent. It's something you will have to give up. Just a couple of two things, and then I'll give a closing thought on this, and I'm open to taking some questions. One is ability to take risk. Whether something will work or not work is absolutely not in your hand. You will discover what is working, and you have to be like a river. You have to take the path that it takes you, so that, and sometimes you have to make a detour. We call this as pivots in terms of business or product we do. But really, you can't say what will work or not. So therefore, your ability to, you know, have enough research, enough information, and understanding of ecosystem, being very plugged to that, and making very prudent calls and taking risk, it becomes very, very important. And also making very tough calls, right? Me as an entrepreneur at Priyanka, at some point, I was present in a situation that I had to sell the company, right? So the question is, I had to take a pragmatic call, or I could have been dogmatic saying, no, I think maybe we are a little early to market, but I'm patient to wait. Or I say that, hey, look, pragmatically, I need to make wealth for the team. So therefore, I'm making decisions. There's no decision right or wrong, but you will end up making very tough calls, which also means you have to let go of your passion at some point. And you have to say, okay, this is fine. My turn will come again. But now I have to be pragmatic. I have to, sunk cost cannot drive your decisions, right? So that's one. Second is, if you're an entrepreneur, you by yourself, you can be an anchor, but you by yourself cannot build everything. So what you need is a team. What you need is a tribe. What you need is people who are like-minded, people who are mission-oriented, people who enjoy a company, people who you can trust, and people who will have fun working with. This becomes very important, right? Be it about Cred or Priyanka or at Agam. That's one thing that I'm very, very proud about. With Agam, 16, 17 years, we have stuck together as a band. We have had our differences. Doesn't mean we don't have differences. But sticking together as a tribe becomes extremely important, and entrepreneurs have to do that. They play a pivotal role in building the tribe, getting them together, fostering the right values, and taking it forward. Now, closing thought, I'll briefly talk about value system at Cred, and why I'll also explain why I'm talking about value system at Cred. The value system at Cred is very much designed to entrepreneurship. And I'll talk about that. I'll give some examples and talk about that. Obsession and skin in the game. These are two different values, very related values. I'm going to talk together about them. At Cred, every single team member gets ESOP, no matter which function, right? Because we believe in creating wealth. We believe in creating a shareholder mindset and not an employee mindset, right? At least. So in terms of fostering that. And why am I saying this is, when you become an entrepreneur, you may want to think about how you will create a shareholder mindset in the team you build, which is going to be very, very important. Without team, just by yourself, I don't think you'll be successful. Second is non-hierarchical openness, right? I think this world, I think experiences per year matters more than years of experience, right? I think we should let the person who has more experiences per year to make a decision. This is one of the value we call it truth-seeking at Cred, right? fostering creativity. New ideas comes from creativity and innovation. You know, it's not about copying some idea. It's about really genuinely going and, you know, letting people who have the creative side, who have strong intuition, let them, give them opportunity to make decisions, and also make sure those creative ideas actually see light and they, you know, let that bloom and create impact, right? So therefore, whenever you are building as an entrepreneur, you're building a startup, it's very important to have, you know, both people who have left brain and right brain spikes, right? It's important. And as an entrepreneur, you need to bring the and converge creativity and execution, right? Because creative people are generally free form. They don't necessarily enjoy process and execution, but without execution, you will not be able to take an idea and take it to a market, right? So you will play a role, there, very clear role. And that value that we define is called deliver outcomes, and keeping promises. But this is how we process that, right? Encouraging craftsmanship. Craftsmanship takes time. I spoke about 17 iterations. Like, we cannot say, hey, like, let's just hack something and put it out. Then taking a view, hey, look, let's get it more right first. When it goes out and people use it, they should feel that, hey, this is very elegant. This is standing out. You need to stand out from the crowd. The time is ripe. So many people are trying to be entrepreneurs. So you're going to be in a, there are going to be a lot of people competing exactly in the same space you're going to be, right? So you need to stand out from the crowd, and therefore you have to be creative and you have to be also patient about that. The other value that broadly I want to talk about is earning trust. There is no entitlement. If you go with an entitlement or if you have ego and you want to be, you are an entrepreneur, many doors will close for you very, very soon. But if you're willing to trade off, you're looking for win-win, many doors will open. So I think shedding ego and, you know, focusing a lot more about building trust and long-term relationship really, really help. Last one I want to talk and sort of take questions is being audacious, right? If you try to play safe, saying, hey, I will try this for 6 months. If it doesn't work, then I'll go for a job. Versus saying, hey, I'm going to really go for this big dream, right? It's okay if it fails, right? I think I would always choose the latter. And in your team as an entrepreneur, you have to create a safe space for people to fail, because you're going to fail, more likely to fail than your success or the milestones, your fundraisers and your first customer and your 1 million customer, all moments which are very, very sparse in the lifetime where you're going to see setbacks after setbacks. So you need to, creating safe space and psychological safety becomes extremely important. So so be audacious, and that's one of a value at CRED. And just want to conclude this saying that, hey, look, great time. Time is ripe for you to be an entrepreneur. Make sure that you're fully in. Make sure that you have your true calling. Make sure that you're really passionate about what you're doing and what you want to achieve. And make that dream really big. Don't play small, safe games. Just go for it. It's okay if you fail. But I think you'd have learned a ton in the process. And the next time you will get it even more right. So, and best wishes to all of you who is taking the entrepreneurial path. Cool. Sanskar, I'll take some questions. There were some questions that were given before. Should I take them?
There are questions in the Q&A section, sir. We can take them.
Okay, cool. So I can go to the Q&A session.
Yeah. I can read out if you can, if you want.
No, I can read out. I have the questions. First question is story of me becoming an entrepreneur. I briefly covered that in the talk. Yes. But what I realized is it is more of a mindset, right? I think I had a lot of learnings when I was a first-time entrepreneur, right? I didn't have the right combination of the founding team. Second is, I think, market, right? My journey was little, I had to learn everything on the go. There was nothing. I really thought it's like, it's going to be a cozy ride. I worked for 15, 18 years, but it wasn't the case. Finding the right composition of founders, finding the right investors who can. I mean, I was lucky enough to meet Kunal Shah and Sandeep Tandon, and they helped in with the seed round for the company. But what you need is really good mentors, and I was lucky enough to get that in terms of in that journey, because I thought I've been here 20 years, I know everything, but I realized I didn't know anything, right? So if I had to sort of summarize, I would say that I went with a certain version of what entrepreneurship will be, but I realized it's like it was 20% is what I thought was true. The other 80% I had to learn. And to learn, you need support from everyone. And because you're going to fail, it is going to be frustrating. Unless and until you have progression, the team is saying that, are we progressing? How are we monetizing? How are we growing? So every day it is about managing your emotions, your team emotions, your organization emotions, managing investors. So it is juggling everything. So in summary, I would say that, hey, go with an open mind. It will take you through as long as you're very clear about what you want to do and your motivators are very internal and not external. I think you will sail through, be open. A lot of surprises, shocks, happiness, everything will come, but just go through the journey. You can read a lot of literature and be prepared and say this, that. At the end of the day, when rubber meets the road, you have to be very adaptable and flexible in terms of how we go through the journey. How can college students overcome the risk of failure and move towards entrepreneurship? I already said that, hey, find your true calling. Don't do entrepreneurship because somebody else did, or someone who you know, your senior or someone else is successful, right? That's good. That's inspiring. But you need to see why you are doing, what you want to do, what is the exact dream that you want to achieve, right? Second, do a lot of research, like spend time in research. Don't go and say, I'll code this and put it out. There is enough data and information available. There is enough research information. Get the research information, go through it, remove subjectivity, remove your bias, talk to people, talk to potential customers, bounce off ideas with friends, family, check if this makes sense. Fixate on value of who am I building this for? What is the problem? What is the problem I'm solving for? What is the value I'm creating? Will someone pay for this value creation? You know, how big the market is. And this becomes very, very important in terms of first really finding out, hey, is it really worth doing? Once you realize that, yes, there is a market and I'm passionate about this and truly this is a viable business model here, then I think you should start be preparing yourself to toil. There is no work-life sort of work-life balance. Your work-life balance is the best definition of work-life balance is for you to identify that, hey, I'm on the verge of breaking down. Now I'm going to take a break, rejuvenate and come back. That's the only work-life balance you have, right? So therefore, be prepared to toil. Be prepared to fail. Be prepared to take blows on your chin, setbacks, ambiguity. It's not everything will be clear. You have to bring clarity because everyone is going to be depending on you if you are the entrepreneur, if you're the founder, CEO, right? You have to stay through it. Don't give up. I mean, tenacity, right? But having said that, also be pragmatic. Like, I'm staying through, but does the end meet? So pragmatism also becomes very important. How
sir,
can...
There are some live questions also. So can we take that also?
Yeah, I had other question to cover, but yeah, can you read out some question?
Yes, sir. The question is from Ram Nivas. Sir, I have a question that when we think about becoming an entrepreneur, at this point of time, capital are not available easily. So, he's asking, I have to choose to make it easier to get capital and continue my business?
No, see, I think when do you need capital? You need capital to scale, unless and until your business itself is capital intensive, right? If you want to prove a business model or a value, I think... not sure if how many of you have heard the story of Gojek. If not, please go and read. Ojek are the people who used to transport people from one point to other. And this was happening for a long time in Indonesia, right? People used to buy cigarettes and whatnot, like small grocery. And when Gojek was started, they started as a call center and they did this for 1 year. They didn't go and build an app. they first demonstrated that, hey, look, there is a value. And there is, if I take a leaf out of Kunal's Delta Flow theory, there is a value and there is a significant improvement in the experience I'm providing for that value, right? I don't think you need to raise money to prove that. I think first, at a small scale, if you can validate hypothesis and if you can generate enough data and get traction, and you put money from your pocket, that's also about sacrifice, right? You believe in something, take small amount of money from your friends and family or from your saving, make it work and show it works. Then you go and raise capital to scale it. Because if you're going to always rely on capital, it will fail, because then you're operating in a state of capital abundance. There is enough capital in the market. If you are able to generate really good idea, with a viable business model, for a large market, and you're solving a real problem and you're solving it really well, and if you can show it even operationally, even with 100, if you make 100 transactions a day, 20 transactions a day, and you prove and you're able to monetize and show, then investors will see that small win. So always I would say, create small wins, quick wins. Don't try to go for scale. Don't try to start with capital. Be very frugal in terms of where you're going to spend your energy, where you're going to spend your resources. Put money from your pocket. You'll realize that every money you spend, you're going to think, is being used in the right way? See, at the end of the day, you create small wins. The outcomes can speak for itself. You don't need to do anything. You just need to present that deck whenever you're doing a pitch to investor. They will know that there is a potential. They will know that you have done your due diligence. They know that you have skin in the game. You have put your own money and make sure you tested the hypothesis and you're coming to them. That's what my answer would be.
Sure, sir. Since we are running out of time, this will be the last question. This question is from Bhavya. What to do when you have different models of your idea? Should we try all or pivot back if it doesn't work? What is the best approach according to you?
Yeah. See, I think there is no guarantee any model will work the way you want to work. At a product level, you can do experimentation. You can do multivariate, A/B and all of that and understand how it works at a feature level. But if you're going after a particular business model, you're trying it, what you need to define is first do the research, thorough research. And you know that there is a market, there is a problem that to be solved. It has not been solved well. And you're trying to solve it and, still you're not getting traction. It is more like you haven't, the problem is the way your approach could be a problem. So go and iterate on the approach. But you really realize that you took some data bias and you have taken a wrong call. Or you realize that you don't really believe in that. Or there could be many reasons why you'd say that this is not working out. Then you ensure you have enough data to say, hey, is work not worked? Why has it not worked? Is it because of external factors or is it because of the way you have implemented? As long as you're sure that it's not because of the way you implemented, I think based on data, you should pivot and be open to pivoting. I pivoted 3 times within 4 months. It also shows that when I started first, I didn't do enough market research. That was my learning. If I had done thorough market research, I might still have pivoted, but not 3 times. Maybe once I might have pivoted. So.
Thank you, sir.
Cool. So, thanks. Thanks, Sanskar. Thanks for the opportunity and best wishes to everyone.
Sure.
And do well, guys.
So I, on the behalf of Entrepreneurship Cell IIT Kharagpur, would like to extend a hearty vote of thanks to Mr. Swami for sharing his experiences with us. We are extremely grateful to him for taking the time to be the part of EDLSM 2021. Thank you so much. And we request audience to please stay tuned for the next session by Mr. Ashish Singhal. We will be back shortly. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks.